reincarnation, dimensions beyond the known. I will speak on two aspects. How does soul enters, and what do we understand by the word that soul enters the body? In the beginning, when you come in meditation, you have many issues. So the work is done on removing those or sorting out those issues. You come to a doctor, you have many complaints. He has to look into your complaints and provide you the solution or the treatment so that those symptoms are removed. This is one aspect of the medical treatment. When you get healthy, do you still need the treatment? That is another aspect, and that's where people stop. That is the time when one should keep on visiting the doctor to get a regular checkup. Then you will be going into the various dimensions of health. So someone, when comes in meditation, he has problems relating to this and that. So all these things are worked on. When all these problems are removed, actually the flower that your being is begins to blossom. You go into the deeper realms of your being. And this is the dimension beyond the known. You come to know about the secrets of the existence. So all these things that we come to know about, issues like these, reincarnation, this and that, these are on the basis of those meditative insights that one explores these deep within. Now, how does soul enter the body? You imagine that someone is there. He puts that soul into it. Soul is something tangible. Is Muslims, they say it is Noor. Hindus say it is consciousness. But whatsoever you say, but we do not know. It is said according to Islamic traditions, God took out the Noor from the forehead of Hazrat Paighambar sallallahu alaihi wasallam and put it into the man. So that means there has to be someone, and then he takes out something, just as you open your wallet and take out $100 bill and give it to you. Or Hindus say it is consciousness, ever expanding consciousness, or the ever existing sound, the unheard, the uncreated sound. What is actually all this all about? Now I will give you an example. The example is, you have an empty piece of land. As such, this empty space, there is an empty space within that space exists the piece of land that you have bought. It is part of one whole space. There is an imaginary boundaries that defines that this is your piece of land. Adjoining to that is the piece of land of the other person, to your left, to your east or west or north or south. There is a road that is also an empty space, part of that, a total empty space in that area. Now you are starting to build the structure. You may fence around, so your space is cordoned out from the space of your neighbors, separated. Yet still it is part of the whole space. It is vulnerable to the sunlight, to the rainfall, just as the other adjoining piece of land are. The construction begins. It goes into the phases according to your plan, the master plan. Slowly and slowly structure is built. Now parallel to this is the growth of the fetus. Ovum and sperm interact with one another. With that interaction between ovum and sperm, the process of the evolution or the construction of the body begins. It is not complete. Your house is not complete. The walls are there, has come into existence. Is so within your piece of land, many more areas are cordoned off for specific purposes. Yet still it is open for sunlight and the raindrops and all that. Then you put up the roof. Again, certain time has passed. The fetus has grown a little more. Then it comes to a stage when your house is completed, but the windows are still needs to be finished. The doors have to be attached. And with that, the light still comes in. But each room has a space within it. Did anybody put that space in this room or that room or anything? It was a part of one big space. First you cordoned off with the boundaries. Then as the structure began, you divided the space into various rooms. Each room occupied a space within it. That space came to be known as the bedroom space, living room space, or the dining area, or the kitchen by different name. Who puts it? It is in the process of the formation, but the fetus grows on its own. As it is growing, the spaces are created. And ultimately, when the building is completed, the doors, the windows, and everything is there, a certain space is encompassed within, or you can say, it is present or encompassed within that framework. That space is, you can call it light, You can call it consciousness. You can call it soul or whatsoever it is. The moment the structure is demolished, everything merges. It's not that their soul leaves the body and goes out. But for the language purpose, we have to see it like that. That the soul leaves the body or soul enters. So when it is said, what time does the soul enter the body? The space is still, while the construction is going on, the roof is not there, the space is not encompassed as yet. The moment everything is complete, the windows, the doors and everything, that the space is encompassed, and then in the light of that space you start doing the decorations or whatsoever it is. So when this space comes in, it illumines everything within, and you start doing your deco or whatsoever it is, arranging it. So in the same way, now this light or this space has come in, it will start now immediately, as soon as the space has been encompassed. You know this is the bedroom, so you start doing the interior decoration according to that. Now you have the instrument, you have the light, and immediately whatever is there that you need to do begins to take place. So as soon as the soul enters, the whole process begins. The memory that was in the seat form, when your vehicle was taken away or you sold it out, you cannot drive the vehicle. You cannot say that you have forgotten to drive the vehicle, but it remains in the seat form, and as soon as a new vehicle comes, everything becomes alive. You started driving it. So as soon as the body comes into existence, all the sense organs, the organs of perception, organs of action become active, the new journey begins. You have gotten a new vehicle and you start journeying. In that, some of the impressions that you have brought with your awareness, you delete it from the memory. Now the computer technology comes in, the current has come up, you have retrieved the information, you realize that many of the information on your desktop or in the document folder is outdated. You bring it to the surface, you read it, see the uselessness. Some of them you need to delete it. But this deletion is happening out of your understanding and awareness, as you may call it. So when something surfaces from deep unconscious or subconscious during meditation or interaction in the interaction in the world of objects and beings, something has surfaced from your document folder or from your other folders, you read it. Without any judgment or without anything, you delete it, simply delete it. It is no more. Your computer is freed of the space that was unnecessarily occupied by the stuff. Now you are creating new documents and you're storing it. So this process is known as karma. You have been born with certain accumulated impressions, and these are part of your subconscious or unconscious memory. You surface it, bring it to the screen, or sometimes the circumstances and situations bring them onto the screen. You analyze it and you wipe it out. Something that was necessary to be kept, that's why you had saved it, but now you realize there is no need to save it anymore. So those past impressions, past memories, past hatred, past moments of jealousy, you bring it, it comes onto the surface. With your change awareness or understanding, you delete it as if that never existed on your memory, and you do not lament over it. Your screen, your system has created extra space, and in that extra space your efficiency increases. You can work with a greater fervor because your desk is cleansed of many unwanted stuff. Your memory of the computer is cleansed of many, and it has given you extra space. You can work very easily without any. So something like that keeps on happening in our life on a day-to-day basis. So whatever the experiences one may have, now the other part is that when the soul leaves the body, what happens? Is it stationary or it has the movement? So whatsoever experience one may have in this interval will be such as can be had without body. As I have said, there will be experience of meditations, but the experience of meditations are had only by a very few persons. Many people buy the computer, but they don't understand the functioning. Someone understands it more than you. So out of millions of people, only one has that experience of meditation. What the experience that others do not have. The others, their experience will be of a dream life. In a dream, no sense participates. When you are dreaming, you are a witness to all that is happening, but neither your organs of perception or organs of action intellect, because these are all dormant. It is possible if a person is in a dream, and if you can keep him in the dream and cut off his limbs, his dreams will not be disturbed, but the chances are his sleep will break. If it were possible to cut off his limbs one after the other without breaking the sleep, then his dream would continue undisturbed, because none of his limbs of the body are necessary for the dream. The body is not at all active in the dreams. There is no use of body. Its organs of perception and organs of action during the dream state. Without the body, dream experience will remain. In fact, all experiences will remain in dream form. If someone were to ask you, whether you are stationary or in movement during a dream, you would find it difficult to reply, difficult to answer. When you wake up from the dream, you will find all along you were lying in the same place, but you were in a dream. And on waking, you will find there had been a long, deep happening in the dream, but remember there was no movement at all. And yet still, you was driving a Mercedes-Benz, you were traveling to different cities, you have married in the dream, and so on and so forth. All the movement, you was not moving at all, this was a stationary, yet still the movement was happening. At one level the movement was happening, at the level of the body there was no movement. The body was stationary in one place, but in a dream state. Does it not happen? That is why religions have put forth the idea that if a person can view this world like a dream, he will have the highest religious experience. From this alone, the theological concept of calling this world as illusion or a dream has been put forward. Hindus were the only ones who have said this world is an illusion. Just that dream is an illusion, you are seeing everything happening, you are participating in everything that is happening in the dream, you are stationary, yet still there is a movement. This is how the, but in the dream, we feel saddened, we feel happy, and these states remain there during the dream. So if you consider your life, your husband, your wife is like a dream, like it is your dream wife, dream husband, dream boyfriend, dream girlfriend, pain and pleasure may come, but you are in a state of dreaming. The person that you call your wife may be there. At a time she was not there, and a moment may come when she will not be again. It's a dreamlike. And if you can interact with all these and yet still remain a witness, something deeper will happen. The deeper meaning of that is, even one can view the life as if it is in a dream, then one becomes a witness. In a dream, one is always a witness and no one is participant. You are not participating in dream. You are lying down, you are watching your body doing everything. This is a state that comes in meditation. Right now your body and your consciousness are embedded into one another like a young coconut tree. The jelly inside is stuck to the inner lining of the shell. It cannot be separated without breaking it. But as the coconut ripens, and a stage comes when this inner jelly can be separated without breaking it. So it happens when the meditation deepens, then you can separate the two and it will not be affected. You can see your body participating in this act or that, but you are not affected by it. During the time when I was growing, the place where my grandfather's shrine is in India, in the city of Lucknow, it was a big compound. And in the center, one corner was the place for residence, and in the center is the shrine. And during that time, the restroom areas were built a little away from the residential area, so that's how it was. So there were two ways. You can take a shortcut or you can take a long cut behind the shrine and you go to the restroom areas, which were in the extreme corner. So along that area, there were trees. So I decided to sit down on the tree to meditate. Because when you are sitting down on the ground, it is the gravitational force of the earth that pulls you. You are not separate from the gravitational pull of the earth. Meditation means you reach to the state where you are not pulled by the gravitational force of the earth or the gravitational force of the body. The body inertia is not pulling you, you are free from that. That is why I said when people come in the beginning, they are pulled by the body inertia, these organs of perception, organs of action, and all these have to be cleared. But the real process of meditation begins when you are free from the gravitational force of these organs of perception, organs of action, and your body, then actual journey begins. So I used to sit down on the tree and meditate. So because I am sitting at a higher elevation, the gravitational force of the earth is much less. Because in a way I am on the ground, because the tree is rooted in the earth, and in a way I am not. So the gravitational force is less. So when you go in the space, the gravitational force is much less. And when you cross the gravitational force of the earth to enter the space of another planet, then you begin to levitate, and that is the experience of the cosmonauts. The astronauts, that they are not affected by the gravitational force of the earth. It was around 5 o'clock during the summer month, when the day is already breaking. I will go and sit down there. And so it happened one day, I was sitting down and a little nap came in, and I fell from the tree. But because it was in a state of meditation, so the two aspects, the being and the body, separated. The body is lying on the ground and the being is still watching from the tree. There is a silver lining that connects the two. The body and this experience is very necessary to experience the moment of death in life. I am seeing the body lying down. I am not in the body, separated. This state is very delicate. During this state, one cannot come back. The two cannot join one another once again, where it can stay for a while. During that time, the touch of the opposite, if you are a male, the touch of the female will help you to restore the connection between the being, the soul, the space, and the body again. So during that time, My grandmother was going to the restroom, so she has to follow the same route. She saw, intuitively she knew, she saw the body lying down. She came, she sat down, put my head onto her lap, and with that, the connection was restored. But this was an experience that remained. This is the experience when you are in dream, you are a witness to all that is happening in dream, but in actual life, you are not a witness to all that is happening. When this experience comes like this, after that, the life is transformed. You do not consider your wife, your husband, your children as your own. They are a gift given to you. They are, during the stage act of 1 hour or 2 hours or 35 years or 45 years, you are given those as the characters to work with you as your dream children, husband and wife. And when the scene is over, everything is finished. You are participating in one way, but you are a witness in another way. Then you realize that you are simply an actor, but in normal day-to-day functioning, you do not consider, you get engrossed into that. So whenever there is an emotional disturbance, you are shattered. But in dream, it does not happen. Though you may see yourself as an actor, you are always, the three things happen. You are an actor, you are a spectator, you are a seer, one who is seeing all that. Therefore, all bodiless experiences will be dream-like, seed-like. Those whose experience have created misery for them will see nightmares and dreams of hell during that state. Those whose experiences have brought them happiness will dream of heaven and will be happy in their dreams. But these are all dream-like experiences. Sometimes different types of events may happen, but these kinds of experiences will differ from person to person. Occasionally it may happen that souls which are neither stationary nor in movement will enter other bodies, but to say that the soul will enter is a linguistic fallacy. It would better be said that somebody may behave in such a way that it will cause soul to enter into it. The world of such souls is not different from ours. That world exists also besides us, close by. We are all residing in the same world. Every inch of the space that is here is filled with souls. The space right here, which appears empty to us, is also full. When the body, the soul, and the soul leaves the body during that interval, depending on the growth of the soul at the time of release from the body, that will determine where the soul will go. So it happens. Those who are advanced, so there are like, see, when you look at the individual, certain individuals are very highly poised. Some are, put it this way here, criminal minded. And in your language, if I have to put it in a Trini language, they are really nasty. So those who are advanced, who are pious, they will seek the company of the spiritual masters and will stay around them to continue their journey during that period of the bodiless consciousness. You will not see them, but the master knows. In Islamic tradition, these souls are known as jinns. The description is, they are all white clad and they come in the company of the enlightened ones, the masters, stay there, continue to evolve during that period of bodiless consciousness, continue to in that restful state until they are ready to enter the body again. On the other hand, those who are less evolved, there are degrees. This is the highest. One shore or one extreme situation. The other is the extremely nasty. And in between everyone, to varying degrees, exist. So souls like these will have to stay in that bodiless consciousness for a longer period of time. So is the case of those who are nasty souls. They will take also a longer period of time for a womb to be created for them to enter again. But ordinarily, when two people are, thousands of people making love every moment, they immediately find the womb and enter. So there are two types of bodies which are in a state of deep receptivity. One is that of who are in great fear. Those who are in great fear cause their soul to contract within their bodies, so much so that they vacate some part of the body completely. Some nearby souls drift into these empty spaces like water entering a ditch. At such time, these souls experience things that only a soul with a body can experience now. There is a great fear or certain things in you. Because of that, you become insensitive to certain things. So in that, in a way, a certain part of your house is not occupied. And if that remains close for a little longer period of time, you will find the children will begin to feel afraid to go into that room on their own. They say that I am afraid, I don't want to go there, there is something there in that room. They are not wrong. The moment, because of the fear, a certain amount of aliveness is lost in that area, or your soul, the space contracts, like you become closed because a certain circumstance and situation has happened in your life. You may be laughing, you may be interacting, but deep down there is a pain, a certain emotions you have pulled in because of that fear. So that means that a particular part of your body, particular part of your inner space is vacated. So what will happen? The nearby souls who are looking for such opportunity, like if that is a situation like that with you, immediately you will find someone who has a similar situation or a situation more grave than yours will become your friend. He has filtered into it. So the nearby soul has drifted into these empty parts like water entering into a space, a ditch. At the same time, these souls experience things which only a soul with a body can experience. Secondly, a soul can enter the body when it is in a deep prayerful moment. In such prayerful moments, also the soul contracts. But during fearful moments, only such souls drift, in which are a great misery and agony. Like when you are in a state of depression, you will find the people who have this similar tendency towards you, like their souls, their consciousness is drifting into you. Only such souls will drift in which there is a great misery and agony, and that sees only nightmares. Those are the ones whom we call as evil spirits, because a frightened person happened to be in an ugly and dirty state. No higher soul will enter into him. So when a person comes with that kind of understanding to a master, master sees him, interacts with him with his compassion, but others will be afraid of him. I have such experiences when somebody comes in into meditation for the first time. The people around the area, they do not like him. They said, "You want this person to be around here?" Things like these I experience on a day-to-day basis. How could you be friendly with such a person? If the doctor will not entertain a sick person whose wounds are oozing or this and that, then who else will work? A fearful person is like a ditch. Only downward moving souls can enter. A prayerful person is like a peak. Upward movement, only the upward moving souls can enter. A prayerful person becomes filled with so much inner fragrance and so much inner beauty that only the higher souls can take interest in him, and such higher souls will enter only what we call invocation, invitation or prayer. Both these types of experiences by souls are such as could be had only with the body. Thus, there is a complete science of invoking the gods. These gods do not descend from some heaven as it is conceived, nor do these whom we call evil spirits come from hell or from devil's workshop or devil's world. They are all present right here, coexisting with us, around us. Actually, in this space, there is a multidimensional existence. For example, in a room where we are sitting, it is full of air. If someone burns some incense, some aromatic substance, the room will be filled with fragrance. If someone sings a melodious song, the sound waves will also fill the room but the smoke of incense will not clash with the waves of the song. The two will coexist together. The room will be filled with music as well as with light, but no light wave will clash with the sound wave, nor will the light wave have to leave to make the room empty for the fragrance to fill the room. Everything exists simultaneously. In fact, this very space is filled in one dimension by sound waves, in another by the light waves, and in the third dimension by the air waves. Likewise, hundreds of things fill this room in hundreds of different dimensions. They do not in any way obstruct or hinder one another. Nor does one thing have to move out of the way for something else to enter. Therefore, all this space that we see around is multidimensional. For example, in this space that we have and you have around you, you have a table. We cannot keep another table in the same space because tables are of one same dimension. But the existence of another dimension will not find the table to be a barrier in another existence. All these souls are very much near us anytime. There can be an entry the moment you are vulnerable. The moment you are vulnerable, you will find someone around you. Immediately he will sympathize with you and enter your space. You are powerless to that. Always, that is why it is said, seek the company of the awakened ones. All these souls are very much near us in the form of influences. Anytime there can be any entry, when the souls enter, then they will have a bodily type of experience, and these experiences are such as can be had only through the bodies. Another factor concerns the way in which these souls enter living bodies, communicate.